Meet the Press with Paul Bongiorno.
Hello and welcome to Meet the Press. Labor's now hoping and probably praying that the passing of the carbon price legislation is a political game changer. The opposition just as desperate to keep the ball in play. Coalition senators did everything they could to delay the inevitable, but in the end, the numbers counted against them.
Order.
Today, we have made history. After all of these years of debate and division, our nation has got the job done. And from the 1st of July, we will see a price on carbon pollution.
The people of Australia voted at the last election for a power-sharing parliament. And I know that the Coalition can't cope with that.
It's the greatest sellout since Judas Iscariot took 30 pieces of silver.
We will seek a mandate from the Australian people at the next election to repeal it.
Under cover of the carbon vote, the government announced the second shelving of the not-so-tender process for its $220 million Australian network satellite service into Asia.
The leak of confidential information made this phase of the tender process a phase which was absolutely crucial in my consideration of an outcome completely untenable.
It's just another bungle, you know, another chapter of incompetence and a long tale of bungling by this government.
Shadow Minister for Communications Malcolm Turnbull is a guest. And later, a special advisor to President Barack Obama, Ed Dasev, joins us. But first, Ali Southwood has what's making news this Sunday, November 13.
Thanks, Paul. Here are the major stories this morning. Prime Minister Julia Gillard has announced an ambitious new free trade deal with Barack Obama and the leaders of seven other Asia-Pacific nations in Hawaii. The Prime Minister says the major development will boost the economies of countries taking part and increase jobs in Australia.
I've said consistently to Australians that trade equals jobs. We are a great trading nation.
The Italian Prime Minister, Silvio Berlusconi, has resigned after Parliament passed a series of austerity measures. The move ends a 17-year political era and sets in motion a transition aimed at bringing Italy back from the brink of economic crisis. The Arab League has finally voted to suspend Syria over its bloody crackdown on anti-government protesters. It will also impose sanctions on a government that has killed more than 3,000 innocent civilians in the past 8 months. And the Sunday Telegraph reports households will face smaller cost of living price increases under the carbon tax than other large economic changes like the GST and the mining boom. A CSIRO report will be released today with Treasury modelling showing consumer costs lower than predicted under an emissions trading scheme. And those are the headlines this morning, Paul.
Thanks, Ellie, and welcome to the program, Malcolm Turnbull. Good morning, Mr. Turnbull.
Good to be with you.
Well, we now have a carbon price in law. There was that modelling that's going to be released today done by the CSIRO suggesting that the impact will be less than Treasury first modelled. So does this feed into Julia Gillard's hope that that the sting, the political sting, will now go out of the carbon tax debate?
Well, I'm sure it does, but, you know, we'll know for sure, won't we, in about 6 months when the carbon tax actually takes effect. So I think households, Australian households, will make up their own minds on the experience after it happens.
How different is what we've got now from the agreement that you and Kevin Rudd came to on carbon pricing?
Well, it is. It's got similarities, but it has got some big differences, and I think it's a worse scheme than the one we agreed to in 2009. The big problem with it is that it is in fact a carbon tax. For the first 3 years, the price is fixed. Now, under the old CPRS, the old emissions trading scheme, the price was fixed at a low, very low price for, relatively low price for 1 year only. And then it fluctuated with supply and demand. Now, that's a very good thing because if you've got a floating carbon price, that's to say the permits are fixed but the price is allowed to float, that means when the economy slows down and demand for energy drops, then the price will come down, and that actually cushions the blow of a declining economy, just like lowering interest rates does. And then ditto, when the economy takes off, energy demand increases, the price will come up and it puts a little bit of a brake on it. So it's a floating carbon price actually operates as something of an automatic stabiliser.
Which is something we'll get to, but longer, yeah.
Well, but for 3 years, and it's being set at a high price, and they've also got a cap and a collar on it, it is a much less flexible system than the one that Kevin Rudd sought to implement.
Now, despite the heat, if you like, and the fury of the carbon debate over recent months and, of course, the vote coming into the parliament, the news poll during the week picked up what looks like an interesting trend. Since September, the gap between the parties after preferences has narrowed from 18 points to 6. Is this something of an amber light, do you think, for the coalition? Do they need to change political tactics or change course now?
Well, look, I think the first thing is that, you know, these polls come and go. It's inevitable that, you know, the government's fortunes will go up and down, but the reality is that they are still in a situation where they're an election held. Mm. Now they would lose and lose very, very badly.
That's true, but trends do matter this far out, don't they? It does look like a trend is happening.
One poll does not
That's true. That's why we talked about a trend.
Yeah. I
noticed that Tony Abbott and certainly the opposition leader in the Senate, as we saw in our opener today, are saying that they will turn the next election into a mandate to repeal the carbon tax. But this mandate argument's overcooked, isn't it? I mean, after all, you had a mandate, as did Kevin Rudd, to introduce a carbon price. That didn't stop Tony Abbott and the Greens from failing to agree to back that mandate.
Well, like, I think, you know, Tony Abbott, having made the commitment, dedicated his political life to repealing the carbon tax and, you know, swearing a blood oath to repeal it, is hardly in a position to change course on this. I think if Tony Abbott is elected Prime Minister, you can be assured that he will do everything he can, every possible thing he can,
and
to repeal the carbon
tax. And you would expect Labor and the Greens to show the same respect for his mandate as he did for theirs?
Well, they might, you know, they might roll over, but I think you'd have to assume that they wouldn't, and that if the Senate voted against it, we'd be back to the polls, you know, perhaps within 6 months or so of an election at a double dissolution to try to get over the Senate deadlock.
Well, going to the government's Australian Network Asia satellite service, which is really, what do they call it, soft diplomacy into Asia, There's no doubt that it's a mess. But should the government never have gotten into this mess, why would you ask commercial news services to do what no other country on earth does, and that is to contract out its diplomacy?
Well, look, the ABC is independent of the government, so the fact that it is owned by the government does not make it a mouthpiece of government policy.
That's true.
Many government ministers have complained over the years.
But it is the national broadcaster.
No, it is the national broadcaster, and I have great affection for it.
Mm-hmm.
But nonetheless, I think it's good to have a tender and you've got Sky there, ready, willing and able to do the job. And I think having that tender is perfectly sensible. The tragedy is that all of the expenses of that tender have been thrown away because of the division and antagonism, the bitter hatreds between ministers, particularly between Rudd and Gillard and Conroy.
Yes.
And all of that makes this government quite dysfunctional. You know, a house divided cannot rule.
Do you think that maybe the Murdoch connection could be a problem here? We know, for example, that Mr. Murdoch had to pull Star News out of China because the Chinese didn't like the news service.
Well, Sky's actually got landing rights in China, so they can actually get their program. They would be able to get a program into China, so I understand.
Mm.
Although that, I think, is a testament to Kerry Stokes's connections rather than Mr. Murdoch's.
OK, time for a break. When we return with the panel, changes at Rupert Murdoch's Australian operation as the phone hacking shockwaves continue in London. And federal parliament sure would be a dull place without Barnaby Joyce. For the second week running, he wins an award for thumbing his nose at the Greens.
You believe they should have green jobs? We'll just send them back to university. They can all do arts degrees. They can all do arts degrees and wander back, and they can pontificate about duck ponds. And about windmills, and they can open up wind chime factories at Nimbin, and have a basket weave. We'll all sit squat leg on the floor and contemplate our upcoming taxes.